Congratulations of Pratham, and so very happy to be here. 10 minutes?
20.
Really? This is a problem of supply and demand.
I was going to give him 25 minutes.
Now there is demand, but no supply. Sorry. Okay. Well, that only means that I can speak for a little longer. I don't think I have that much to say, especially since Giridhar and Vaijanti are both here, and people who are engaged with the learning outcomes in Pratham, the Asar gang, is actually not here. So I'll just slash my bat a little bit here and there and hope not to get caught outside the ostrum. I was very happy to see this English training program and its outcomes in the film. Actually, Shubhangi is sitting right here. What?
I'm her twin sister.
Sorry? Shubhangi's sister? Oh, no, God. She's a twin. I was wondering, why does she look like this and why Shubhangi is here? Anyway, let's pretend that there's Shubhangi who looks exactly like her. I know. I never seen her. I know. So, Shubhangi, the twin sister, actually had done a similar program across Himachal Pradesh, and in the entire Pratham network now, English programs were being replicated elsewhere. So that's good news. I want to not talk about all the things that are true about learning outcomes and assessment and all that. So I just want to, since it's keynote, I hold the key, you are the locks. So I may not be able to open it. I've been thinking, we started talking about learning outcomes in Pratham somewhere around 2002-03. Before that, I don't think we talked about learning outcomes, and I don't think many people outside the network were, as a matter of policy or as educational systems, were talking about learning outcomes either. There was assessment going on, but then with the learning to read program that we started, we began to realize that a huge proportion of children who go to school do not learn. And then as a necessity of our own program, we devised a testing tool, and it was something that was fitting the program, the resources that we had, the human resources that we had. And we wanted to make a learning tool that was fairly simple, not for experts, but for people who are working in the slum communities to figure out what the learning level of the child is. And so a learning tool emerged, and by 2004, as Drin informed you, I was put in the National Advisory Council and then not put again after 2008. When the discussion started on what needs to be done across the country, one of the suggestions I put forward was that the government should come out with a status of education report. While it was accepted that yes, it is a good idea, but nobody actually wanted to do it. And that's how Pratham actually got into a nationwide effort called ASER, Annual Status of Education Report. It was variously criticized or appreciated by depending upon who was looking at it. But I think after now 6 years of doing ASER, etc., etc., and many things have happened over the last 6 years, it's fair to ask a question as to who needs to know. And I think there are different stakeholders who need to know. One is there is a need for the government to know whether the government system is performing or not, and then they must come up with criteria for performance that they must check. And whether it's learning outcomes or inputs and whether there is efficiency of the system and so on. The second is educators and people who are actually educationists, who also want to know, because that is something that they want to give back to the system, improving the system, actually teaching methodology, the diagnostics, and so on and so forth. And often what happens is, and I think ASER was appreciated by a lot of people, and I find it funny that we do a lot of work on the ground of teaching children, like the film you saw, and that doesn't receive the kind of attention that an ASER receives, because ASER and testing and assessment is policy, and policy is sexy. But the fact is that whether a child is learning or not, to know this is equally important for the parent. And how does the parent know whether my child is learning or not? I don't know how many of you know whether your children are learning in school or not, or were learning in school or not. But by and large, we really, as parents, don't really know, unless you are actually sitting down with the child's homework and you don't know the volume of homework the child has to have, what the child needs to learn, and so on. And when you go into the government schools, the parents are really not aware, large numbers of people. We found that there were two segments who were not really aware. One was the children, I mean the parents, and the second was policymakers. Neither were aware that learning was not happening. Parents were basically taking it for granted that children go to school, and so there must be learning. And exactly that's what's happening with policymakers also. We have got schools, we've given so much. So all this is there. What do you mean children are not learning? But the fact that children are not learning to the level that we want them to learn was quite a shock to a number of people. So my first point is that parents need to know, and so there have to be simple instruments by which parents will know whether you do an assessment regularly or not, or whether a simple word statement goes back to a parent saying, now your child can read. Simple and straight, if that can be done, then it's a useful thing to do. Now your child speaks, or your child doesn't speak in the class. That simple report back to the child. I don't want to look at you because I keep thinking, Shubhangi. So, sorry. So, what's your name, incidentally?
Shivangi.
Shivangi. See? Okay. So, that is my first point. The second point is that having gone through all these things, now in the last four or five years, many people have done large-scale education initiatives, has done large-scale testing, assessment. I think Azim Premji Foundation has been doing for some time. Asar comes every year. But there is, with so many assessments happening now, people are saying, so what is happening here? Because everything doesn't actually coordinate. You can't sit and say, okay, this is right and that is wrong. Many, many assessments are happening. And also, while many assessments are happening, we are not sure whether the government has actually come out and said, this is the kind of learning outcome we need. In fact, it seems to me that the Right to Education Act is running away from defining learning outcomes at all, completely. Maybe that's a good way of going and leaving it. Don't define the learning outcome, jo hoga so ho jayega. But I think there is a need to now define as to what are the stage, at least stage level, forget the grade level, stage level learning outcomes. Is it possible for us to arrive at some kind of an understanding as to what are the basic learning outcomes that we need? We started by measuring reading, and we started by measuring simple arithmetic. Okay, we are happy to change it again completely. If there is a consensus that these are not the learning outcomes to measure at certain stages, what is it that we should measure? When a child enters the school, let's say there's so many levels, we're talking about 0 to 2 years and 3 to 5 years and then 5 to 8 years and so on. Then at the entrance level of the child, what should the child be doing or not doing? Or we don't want to worry about that. Because if there is a preschool segment, there is an Anganwadi, then what is the minimum that the Anganwadi should be able to bring the child up to? What is that school readiness that Vinita was talking about? Exactly what is that? So that the Anganwadi is prepared. If it means that the child should know how to move around, how to sit and talk, speech and saying certain things or not saying certain things, I don't know what it is, but we need to say what is that school readiness and put down that as a goal to be achieved and see whether 80%, 90% of our children can actually reach that level, so that you've created a scaffolding over which you can build from the first grade onwards. I don't know whether that is possible or not. Similarly, first and second grade. Now, there are many, it's being recognized as a policy matter, and everybody understands it, that we want to have child-centered learning. And that is being interpreted variously. And I keep wondering, we have a mass education system. And a mass education system, to me, is always going to have inherent limitations of how much child-centered teaching will happen or how much freedom a teacher will have. As long as you run it like a mass system, there is going to be a problem. And within that, then we start doing your activity-based learning and we try to do all kinds of experiments, again done on a mass scale. And we say that we are going to make it more child-centered, and the teacher will have autonomy, but you must do exactly this. On day one, you'll do this. Day two, you'll this, and so on and so forth. So there's a problem there. But why not then My own feeling is, if you say that, don't worry. I mean, in a sense, our backwardness is our advantage, and we have to use it as an advantage. People keep saying that if you have a challenge, you can always convert it into an opportunity. Our challenge is that across the country, especially in the rural areas, and many urban schools also, we have multi-layered, multi-graded, all kinds of child systems. And while all these children are sitting together, we are pretending that there is standard 1, standard 2, standard 3, standard 4, and then Right to Education Act comes and says if the child is so many years old, then he must be in certain standard. Never mind what the grade is. So we are creating a lot of confusion by saying that there is a standard. First of all, we know that learning doesn't happen according to standards. If that is true, why are we creating standards? Why are we reinforcing standards? If the reality is that we actually have multi-layered classrooms of multi-level, multi-grade, then why not use it to our advantage? And how can we do that? How can that be made possible? Because again, in a number of places, in the remedial portion at least, what we've tried to do is you put children in groups according to their levels of learning, whether it is math or English or whatever, and then let the group learn, and then as you learn better, you move to another group. Now, these are things that have been done in many places. There's nothing new that I'm telling you about. But if this is the case, can we come out with an end of stage learning goals and broad ones, not the very specific lesson number 15 of textbook X? That doesn't help. Why can't we say that by the end of second grade or that level, age or whatever, the child should be able to read fluently and do certain simple quantitative analytical pattern recognition kind of stuff? Just a broad recognition, because that will help as a guideline rather than giving every detail of what should be in what lesson and what subject is to be taught, because it's creating too many things and we don't know whether that's actually going to be learnt or not. So I would think that and since the accepted stages are, I think, second standard today, fifth standard or fourth standard in some states, fourth standard now, fifth standard and seventh and eighth and so on. Maybe beyond fifth, we don't need to get into that. But at least up to fifth grade, where the preparation of the child has to be for whatever he or she is going to learn, to complete elementary education properly, to complete secondary, prepare for tertiary of any kind. So maybe we need to have basically broad goals that we want to see as outcomes and not every last outcome. You can say that a child cannot solve this problem or that problem or this is not taught properly, but what are the broad goals? And if we don't define those broad goals that we want to see, then the parents will find it more and more difficult to figure out. By when should my child learn to read? Unhe wo panchvi mein jayega to padh lega. I mean, that doesn't work, because by the time you're lagging behind and many things change. So I think this is extremely important to do, according to me. And whether it is possible for people outside the government to come together and come to some understanding of what these broad goals are. I don't know whether you can do it in Karnataka or not. If you can do it in Karnataka, we can do it in other states also. Or maybe we can bring together civil society members and say, what do you think? Not the details. Because ultimately, the drivers of this are going to be the parents. Like Vinita was saying, and we know this in the Balwadi, that parents want the children to start writing right now, because they see that whichever middle class homes they go to, their children, even if they're 3-year-old, they're doing cursive writing. So that is the model that they are following. So I think that is something that is required. Now, once that is done, and I think my 6-7 minutes are up, I just want to suggest something totally different. And it's not, once you accept that we are going to have multi-level and multi-grade groups sitting together, then I don't understand why we have textbooks. I really don't understand. It's because the industry requires textbooks and because the curriculum requires textbooks. And then we say we blame the textbook because the teacher sticks to the textbook. Look at the economy of the textbooks also. If there is a school, or let's say like a class, which has 30 students, then those 30 students will have their Bal Bharati and then their EVS and then their math textbook, right? And those three textbooks multiplied by 30 people is 90 books, Akshara, Pratham books. Think about it. Now, if there are 90 books to be printed, you can actually have a library for those children of 90 books. And there could be some math books and there could be some. It doesn't have to be one standard book for everyone. You can have worksheets that are standard.